What's going on, Transformation Church? I just wanted to let you know how excited I am that we are in a season of generosity and giving. And I'm so grateful that you are a part of what God is doing to spread the gospel all around the world so people can be transformed in Christ. You know, every year, even this year, even 2020, we've decided that we are going to walk by faith. And every year at the end of the year, we ask God, God, is there something that you want us to give above our normal tithe and offering to expand the vision of Transformation Church? And year after year, people just like you stand up and say, God, I'm gonna trust you, I'm gonna hear you, and I'm going to give. And this is what we're gonna do again. Despite the pandemic, despite all of the things that are going on, we are not gonna back down or back up. We are going to advance as a church. And I'm asking you and your family to pray and ask God how you're supposed to participate in this year. Every year we give in faith, but this year God told me, Michael, it's time to give in crazy faith again. And that's what I'm challenging you. I want you to ask God, when the circumstances look probably unfavorable, I want you to ask God, what would you have me to do in crazy faith? And as a church, on December 6th, we are going to give. You can honestly give from right now all the way through December 6th and even after, but we're going to join our faith together and we're going to come together to expand this vision. God told us that the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. And at the moment where everything is seeming like it's shutting down, God's church is going to move forward. And me and you have a part to play in that. The thing I want everybody to understand that this is not about amounts. This is not about what we can do or cannot do. This is about everybody doing what God asks them to do. And when we do that, man, there is so much that can happen with everybody doing exactly what God has called them to do. This is the time where I ask you, if this ministry has been a blessing to you at all, we have tons of people watching, tons of people getting fed and not really participating. This is your time to jump in the game and participate. Over your tithe, over your offering, we want to give something to expand this vision. We wanted to take it even a step further because we know that this is a sacred moment for many. And right now, while many people are on lockdown or can't travel, there's some people right here in Tulsa and some people in surrounding areas that want to come and give. We have created sacred spaces for you to come safely and securely give. This is a space where you can listen to worship music, write down your crazy faith belief, and really just be able to say, God, I'm going to end this year trusting you and believing you so that I can start next year trusting you and believing you. And we're excited around here because we know every time we have an opportunity to grow our faith, God blows our mind. So from November 30th to December 6th, you can come and give and see what God will do with our crazy faith. I love you, I'm proud of you, and I cannot wait to see the miracles that happen as we walk by faith. Well, we made it to week 10. Oh, come on, of a series we're calling Help Me, F You. And for everybody who's slightly offended by the title of this message, all it means is Forgiveness University. I found that so many people have an education on things they never really need to use. Come on, let's be honest. How many of y'all don't use half the stuff you learned in high school? Come on, hands lifted all over. I wanna see you in the chat. You don't use the Pythagorean theories and the chemistry. And what else do we don't not use? What else did, what is it? They said everything. Okay, so we didn't use barely anything, okay? How many of y'all don't use half the stuff you learned in college? Come on, let's be honest right now, okay? Like, don't use it at all. Calculus, what? But what I found is that the education system is not responsible for your emotional and spiritual development. And what ends up happening, what affects us more in our life is not if we can solve an algebraic equation. It's if we can learn how to let go of or subtract the things in our life that keep us stuck. And one of the things that hold people down is this thing called unforgiveness.
And the crazy thing about it is you can be raised in church, because a lot of people are like, well, I wasn't raised in church. It's okay, I was. And they still didn't teach us about forgiving people. We knew we should do it, but nobody taught us how to do it. And for the last 9 weeks, we've been on a journey trying to get a master's degree, like God, our master, get a master's degree in something that will change our destiny. And hear me when I say this. If you forgive, this can transform your entire life. Now, I know people right now are trying to figure out, well, when is everybody going to come back and apologize to me? And we're going to have to dig up Uncle Reginald, because you know what he did to me. And I'm not forgiven till he says from the grave, I'm sorry. See, one of the things that we in our culture think is somehow if we hold unforgiveness, we're somehow punishing the other person. Which it is exactly the opposite of that, that when we do not forgive, it is like drinking poison waiting for somebody else to die. And today, through this series, God wants you free. And I keep telling people this over and over. That's why I said we go in 10 weeks. And honestly, I have so much to say that I'm vacillating if we don't take this one more week. It might be F you till Christmas. I might wear that on a shirt. F you till Christmas. The reason I'm saying that is because what if the greatest thing that you did in 2020 was walk free because you forgave? Okay, because some of y'all are like, I don't need that. Think about the person that if they walked into the room right now, it would change your whole attitude. Oh, you know them. Some of y'all can smell them. Some of you can hear their nasty laugh. Some of y'all can just see them. You work with them. Some of y'all sitting right next to them. Uh-oh, don't look. Look straight, look straight, look straight. What happens if you really forgave them for what they said? And not just forget about it until another argument comes up and you pull that mug out like a Uzi. But you remember, pow, 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 pow. Y'all know how we do. We wait for a more opportune time to bring up people's failures and how they hurt us. We're living guarded and gated by offense. There are so many people that you have blocked and unfollowed and all that other stuff. And I'm not saying that's bad, but what if God called you to minister to them in real life and you're so offended by them through social media that at the moment God brings them into your sphere, you have nothing to say to them? All I'm asking you is, could you enroll into something that God would produce freedom in your life and forgive? Everybody say, I will forgive. This may be a faith statement for somebody right now, but I want you to say it again. I will forgive. And that's why it's been 9 weeks. We talked about the gift of forgiveness in week one. Week two, offense under construction. Then we went to forgiven ultimately. Forgiveness understood. Start with forgiving you and then framing unforgiveness and forgiving unfair. And then we went to fathers unaware. And then last week, my friend Lisa Turkers came in and so transparently shared about failure being useful. And I still, after all of that, had somebody email me this week after watching all of the series, and they asked me this one question that I'm going to answer for everybody in the service. They said, I heard all the messages, Pastor Mike, but they literally said, why do I need to forgive? I was like, we just spent 9 weeks, and you still don't know? And the person said, it just seems like opening up an old can that I've already closed. And it just feels like too much energy. Some things don't need to be bothered. And I said, okay. So I said, did you eat Thanksgiving? They said, yeah. I said, did you have any leftovers? They said, yeah. I said, how many days is it legal for your leftovers to stay in the refrigerator? Now, this is a debate of the century right now, because some of y'all like your leftovers in there for 2 weeks. You understand? Some of y'all, okay, let's just do a hand. How many days in the chat right now? Are leftovers thrown away in 2 days? 3 days? What are y'all in the room? 4 days? How long will you let them stay in there? I see 5. I see 6. I see 1 week. Somebody said 10. Somebody said a month. Your stomach must be made of steel. Okay? But I started asking them how long, and the person said about 3 days, like 3 days. I said, what if you left that Thanksgiving dinner in your refrigerator forever? What once was something you felt like you had contained will begin to fester and spread not only to the dish it was in, but it will begin to take over the entire refrigerator, seep out of the cracks of the refrigerator and take over the kitchen. Go out of the kitchen and seep into the living room. Go from the living room, get in your bedroom. Go from your entire house to the neighbor's house. That one thing that you let sit there that you thought you had contained will end up contaminating your entire household. Because you never dealt with what was there just sitting. And I'm sad to say that I feel like many of our lives are reeking of unforgiveness. I want to help you. And that's why I'm going to answer that question for you. Why do I need to forgive? Write this down. Write this down. Because unforgiveness always limits your future. If you do not forgive, you are automatically putting a limit on your future. What are you saying, Pastor Mike? Now God cannot use you in every door he wants to take you in, because there are people that you are so offended by. There are things you will not share with anybody. There are places you won't go because they remind you of a place you were hurt and you never got healed from that. And God says, now you have put limits on what I can do and where I can take you, because unforgiveness always limits your future. Yep. I found this out firsthand, especially being a pastor. What happens when people you have bad business deals with, that walked out on you, that left you, that talked bad about you, and you know it? Then God says, do business with them again. Go pray for their kids. Give to their nonprofit organization. What? He said, oh, because you didn't forgive, you've limited me. Oh, I can't take you into that career, because what you don't know is the boyfriend that offended you when you were 22 and you never forgave now is an executive at that company. And I want to take you in there to represent me. But as soon as he walks in the boardroom, because you didn't resolve what needed to be resolved and release them of the debt a decade ago, now you are no longer sober-minded to be used by me in wisdom in that room. You're thinking about how you feel. You've limited me. I'm telling you that there are more people that God would say, because I want to get glory, I'll use the foolish things to confound the wise. I'll take you into positions and places that nobody thought you could be in, and I'll represent. I've made and prepared a table for you in the presence of your enemies. The problem is you got a seat, but you would get up because of an offense. Woo! I'm preaching. Because the people at the table you have not forgiven, you have not released them. God has prepared an entire table for you to go in there free of the offense, free of all of the shame, free of all of the guilt, and it'll have your name on it, and you'll sit down, look around the table, be offended, and get up from the table that was prepared for you. Because you did not forgive. Why do I need to forgive? Because I want my, this is the title of my message, future unlimited. How many people want their future unlimited? How many people want to be able to do whatever God says for them to do? Give to whoever God says to give to. Be able to interact with anybody. God says if you do not forgive now, you are putting handcuffs on your future for then. And I know it's hard to think about because we don't think long term. We think about right now, maybe tomorrow, maybe next week. But God is a generational God. What if your offense for that person passes to your children and it limits them? We don't mess with the Johnsons. Why? I don't know. Just my daddy didn't mess with the Johnsons, so I don't mess with the Johnsons. What do you mean? Like, why don't you mess with the Johnsons? Like, it's just them Johnsons. Something wrong with them. They lie. They do this. They do that. And you literally don't have a problem with them, but you transferred offense. And now God called for you and the Johnson family to create something that would give him glory. But because you're carrying borrowed offense. Y'all know how we praise in culture friends who will just like jump on with whatever a friend is doing, whether they right or wrong, and we call them ride or die. It's like, it don't even matter if she's wrong. If you come up here, I'm gonna fight you like I don't even know you. That's dumb. Because there are people in this world that don't like other people, not because of their own experience, because of the skewed view of somebody else's experience with them. And God said, it ain't worth picking up that offense because it's going to limit your future. Okay, I'm gonna have to walk through this. It's so important to God that when the disciples asked Jesus, how should we pray? Because you got a different way of praying than us. Literally in the Lord's Prayer, this is what Jesus thought out of everything in the world to put in there. He puts this in Matthew 6 and 9. He said, pray in this manner. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come. Hey, your will be done. Yes, on earth as it is in heaven. This is where the church likes to focus. Give us this day our daily bread. Provide for us, God. Give us our daily bread. But then look what it says in verse 12. And forgive us our debts. Thank you for grace. As we. Like, do it for us as we actively are forgiving the people who have done us wrong. It's so important that you walk free of unforgiveness that God says, I want you to pray this in my prayer. Forgive us our debts as we. Somebody say as we. That means you have to actively, it is not a one-time thing. You have to actively forgive other people how and who have made debts against you. What are you trying to say, Pastor Mike? Write this point down. Forgiveness is releasing people of the debt. They owe you, and you're going to say, you don't have to pay me back. Now, that is the most un-American thought process that we have probably talked about in this series. But can I tell you that when you become a believer and you are putting your faith in Jesus Christ, you are no longer a citizen of America first. You are a citizen of the kingdom of God. And everything done in the kingdom of God is done differently. God says, I don't have a shortness of supply of grace for you. So when people do you wrong, and I know somebody's tuning off right now because you don't know how to do this in your life, I'm gonna help you. Stay with me. When you don't have it to do in you, God supplies his grace. He just said, don't play me like I didn't just let you free. Like, don't play me like I saw everything you did and I still blessed you and I still gave you the position and I still called you my child, and then you go talk to them and you play them like I didn't play you. You better look like me if you want the grace that I have for you. You better extend it to somebody else. And this is where the church wants all the grace for themselves but wants to give just a little bit. Just a little bit. To those who do them wrong. And Jesus saying, no, forgiveness, what the real blame, the real bottom line of it is forgiving and releasing people of the debt. And that's why I'm saying when you release people of the debt, your future becomes unlimited. There are people right now that I should hate, that honestly, I feel bad for now. Because the way they hurt me, the way they played me, the way they talked about me in the ministry and my family, it let me know that there was something really broken on the inside of them. And God said, are you going to stoop down outside of my grace to that level, or are you going to release them of the debt? And this is a beautiful picture because you need to know this. Forgiveness always affects the future. I'm saying the same thing in different ways because I'm hoping it dawns on you. Forgiveness, when you do it, it always affects the future. Look what the Bible says in Matthew 18, 21. And I like this because the disciples are a lot like us. They just trying to figure it out. All right, Jesus, you said it, but give me, all right, help me understand. Because this is where Peter says, you know, Jesus, how many times should we forgive? Seven? And Jesus is like, boy, you tripping. All the stuff you be doing, cutting people's ear off, all this other stuff. No. 70 times seven. And the disciples are like, No, that's too much. And Jesus, because he knows that the 70 times seven, when you're forgiving somebody, it's not about trying to keep a count of what's going on. It's about losing count of what's going on. And a lot of people are right here holding on to everything. And God says, let me just tell you a story so you can understand. Everybody say the kingdom. Say it again, the kingdom. Okay. It says, Matthew 18, 21. Then Peter came to him and asked, Lord, how often should I forgive someone who sins against me? Seven times? No, not seven times, Jesus replied, but 70 times seven. Because forgiveness is not about keeping score, it's about losing count, okay? Matthew 18, 23. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a king who decided to bring his accounts up to date with his servants who had borrowed money from him, okay? In this process, one of his debtors, somebody who owed the king, was brought to him. He owed him millions of dollars. Verse 25, he couldn't pay. So his master ordered that he be sold along with his wife and his kids and everything he owned to pay the debt. Now, this actually encourages me because Jesus allows the king to have an emotion. Like, that's how I would be. Like, you owe me millions? Like, millions of dollars? And you can't pay me back? Sell everything. Sell Jerome. Sell Trisha. Sell the ugly little kids and the dog. And sell them all. And he's able to have this emotion, which many of us do when people do us wrong. But watch this. He must have heard FU series somewhere because he has a heart transformation in one verse. Listen to it. He said he couldn't pay. Sell everybody. Verse 26, but the man fell down before his master and begged him, please be patient with me and I will pay it all. So he had the audacity to know he had no money, but he was going to work until it was paid. Then his master was filled with pity for him. Another translation I love says he was moved with compassion. And it said, and he released him and forgave him of the debt. Oh my goodness. Like, hold on. If it was me, I have to reverse engineer this scripture. If he said, be patient with me, I need some more time, I'll pay it. Most of us would be like, okay, I'll give you two more months, but you still owe me. Like, I don't even care about like what's going on. I'll give you some more time. I had compassion. I'll give you some more time, but I promise you, you're gonna pay me. What this king did, which is the same thing that Jesus is comparing the kingdom to, is they still owe you, but he released the entire debt. Can we do that for our coworkers? Can we do that for our fathers that are unaware? Can we do that for ourselves? Can we release ourselves of the debt? That is the most kingdom thing you can do. And this guy, his future in one moment becomes unlimited. He went from being in jail with his entire family to being forgiven, and now he has a future to live out. He has a future to be able to go and bless other people. He has a future to be able to stand and declare how good the king has been. He has a future to be able to come up with more business. He has a future to be able to do more. But look at what happens. And this is so many times what happens to us and why we need to be able to forgive. Because the thing that you find out through the king's actions is forgiveness is not about what they deserve. It is about what God desires. Nobody will ever deserve your forgiveness. God desires for us to forgive. The same way we did not deserve his forgiveness, but he desired to make a way through Jesus so we could be forgiven. This will not be fair. It will be faith. You missed it. Everybody wants crazy faith for things. And God says the strongest thing you can believe me for is the faith to actually forgive them. To know that just letting them go doesn't mean they were right. Doesn't mean that they were justified. It means you're justified. That you are blood bought. And God has transformed your life. It's not what they deserve. It's what he desires. And this is where most people won't get it. Because they want somebody to deserve their forgiveness, but you've never deserved anything that God has done for you. Excuse me, I'll talk not for you, I'll talk for me. I've never deserved the grace. How God took me from being so manipulative, so perverted in my thoughts towards women, so messed up on the inside of what success was. I can never repay God. So my attempt is giving him my whole life. Whatever you want from me, however you want it, you want me to lay down music for 12 years and become a pastor? It is my only reasonable response for the forgiveness you've produced for me. You want me to stop sleeping around? You want me to give up pornography? Because of the grace and the forgiveness you've extended to me, it is only my reasonable response to give you everything of my life. You bless me with this job and you want me to give how much in a crazy faith offering? You know what? It don't even matter, because the forgiveness you have given me, when I had a case 6 years ago and I could have been in jail for car insurance fraud, and you saw fit to just let me get out of that with community service. Oh, I'm not talking about somebody else. I'm talking about your pastor. I'm talking about in the view of the mercy and the forgiveness of God, my only response is to do that for somebody else. And that's why I know too many of you have forgotten what God's brought you from. You've started to think that somehow you got here on your own. That somehow was your education. Somehow it was your networking. Somehow it was your, and God is saying, will you please remember that I forgave you, that I found you in the trap house, that I found you in the White House, that I found you wherever you were, and I let my grace, my mercy, and my forgiveness extend to you? Will you live like it? But what happens? In Matthew 18, 23, verse 28, it says, but when the man left with a future that was unlimited, just had his debt canceled, probably see walking out of the palace, you know what I'm saying? Like, he had just been literally forgiven of all his debt. Then he went to a fellow servant who owed him a few $1,000s. Uh-oh, he owed millions. But he found somebody that owed him a few thousand. He grabbed them by the throat and demanded instant payment. This is the Bible, and the Bible is good. It's like better than any Netflix series you can ever watch, because I can see the whole thing in a movie. His fellow servant fell down, kind of like Nate Robinson last night in the fight. It said before, that was funny. He fell, and the servant fell down before him and begged, please just give me a little more time. It's so funny that he says the exact words that he said to the king, they were now said to him. Because many times the people you need to forgive, you need to forgive them for some of the same heart postures and attitudes that you had in a different situation. He said, be patient with me and I will pay it, he pleaded. But his creditor wouldn't wait. He had the man arrested, put in prison, until the debt could be paid in full. When some of the other servants saw this, they were very upset. They went to the king and they told everything that had happened. The king called in the man that he had forgiven and said, you are an evil servant. I forgave you of the tremendous debt because you pleaded with me. I had compassion on you. I showed my grace and my mercy to you. Shouldn't you have the mercy, the grace, the forgiveness on your fellow servant, just as I had mercy on you? And remember, this is Jesus comparing this to the kingdom of God, okay? He says, then the angry king sent the man to prison to be tortured until he paid the entire debt. And then Jesus comes back to present day and says to us, and this is strong, get ready for it. That's what my heavenly Father will do to you if you refuse to forgive your brothers and sister from your heart. I will allow your future to be unlimited, but if you don't extend it to somebody else, he said, you're going to get the same thing that was prepared for you at first. I said, God, help me get your people to understand this. He gave me this very simple phrase that I hope that you just remember forever. Releasing the debt releases your future. it's not worth it to be mad at her anymore. It's not worth it. Well, she cheated. My husband cheated with her and I hate her guts and all that other stuff. Listen, it's not worth your future. It probably hurt. It's probably disgusting. But it's not worth your future. Release the debt. Release your future. Pastor Mike, it's not that easy. They violated me. I understand. Listen to me. I need you to hear me say this so clearly. I need you to be awake at this moment and hear what I'm saying to you. It may not be your fault, but it is now your responsibility. You can't be held hostage another day waiting for their freedom. They may never get it. They may never get to the place where they're emotionally aware enough to know what they did. They may never change. Their pride may never. But God is saying, I'm giving you a key today to be able to unlock your future. And releasing the debt releases your future. Yeah, it's too simple. It's too simple. And you're going to need the Holy Spirit's help to do it. Because releasing debt is not hard when they owe you. Like, they owe me. They should at least say sorry. They should at least recognize they weren't good parents. They should at least come back and say sorry for not picking me for the team. They should at least, they exposed me to that too early. They did this, they did that. I did this, I did that. And God's saying, you can't control none of them, but you can give me all of you. You can't control none of them. Your daddy, your uncle, that coworker, that friend. You cannot control any of them. But you can right now give God all of you. I know it's hard for people to get it like that. So I have a practical example to help you understand releasing debt. Okay? So that's all forgiveness is. Forgiveness is releasing the debt. And then it releases your future. Let me give you a practical financially so that it may parallel to something that can happen for you emotionally and spiritually, okay? So back in 2014, Bishop came to me and said, you're gonna be the pastor of Transformation Church. I was like, hex to the all. And he was like, it's gonna happen, but there's a burden I have. I need to make sure that our 33,000 square feet converted grocery store is paid off. It needs to be paid off. I need the debt to be released. I need the debt to be canceled on this whole situation. And I was like, Bishop, why? It's not that serious. We can make something happen. He was like, no. I need the debt to be released. And on 2014, I remember watching Bishop believe God in crazy faith, him and Pastor Debbie, and rally our church and begin to believe. And people gave and people like, we're about to give in our crazy faith offering. They just begin to believe like releasing the debt would change something. And literally July 2014, here's a picture of our old building. God allowed the debt to be retired on this building. And then in February, yeah, you can give God praise for that. And then in February, I became the lead pastor. It was like him making sure that the debt was released. It released our future. And when I became the pastor of the church, I'm just trying to make it very practical, because Bishop went ahead and made sure it was paid in full, he released us of the debt. Then I was able, as a young pastor, to hear God's voice without that pressure on me. And what did God tell me to do? He told me to spend $80,000 on cameras. Now, everybody watching me right now probably would not be watching me right now, would not have gotten relationship goals marked, planted, not buried, crazy faith. You wouldn't have got any of those series if Bishop would not have had the foresight to get the debt released from our situation, because releasing the debt releases the future. We were able to stand, and people, just like we're about to give in the crazy faith offering, they begin to give, and we raised that $80,000. It didn't come without opposition. People left the church. They thought it was foolish. They thought, there's no way God told you to do this. But sometimes when you're standing in crazy faith, you got to stand alone. Sometimes you got to know that you know that you know that God asked you to do something. And I rallied the 300 people in our church, and we raised that money, and we begin to believe God. Then we went for a series of time of just being faithful and consistent and challenging our faith day after day. And we went from one service to two services to three services all the way to five services. And your boy was dying, okay? Very clearly, I was wore out, but God was blessing our ministry. And God, I'd prayed, and he had told me he was going to release a building to us. And he gave me this vision of the place we are in right now, when we had no money, when there was barely nobody coming to the church. 37 days after I became the lead pastor of the church, I'm getting excited right now because I can feel somebody's faith rising, because all you have is all you need. God is not looking for anything else except for you to obey. And that's why releasing the debt is so important. And so we came into this place of being debt free. So we started to save. We started to bless other ministries. We started to partner with nonprofits to end sex trafficking and to help people getting out of jail and to be able to help churches meet the needs for food. And we started doing all this stuff. And then we started saving in crazy faith for the next building that God would give us. And y'all know this ain't even been a long time, but the building I stand in right now, it was only a year ago that we stepped in this building in August, and God allowed us to acquire this building. And I stood in crazy faith at the first day I announced it, and you can go back and watch the video, and I said that God has given me a burden that this needs to be paid off in the next 6 months. It needs to be paid in full. That was $10.5 million. I don't know what the heck I was thinking, except God was giving me a burden and showing me a blueprint that if the debt is released, it releases the future. And so we stood there in crazy faith, and some gangsters that I know y'all watching right now stood, and we gave, and literally we bought, y'all don't understand how crazy this is. We bought this building in August and paid it off in February. Y'all, oh, come on. Somebody needs to just get excited with me in crazy faith, because anything God does for this house, he's trying to give you a pattern to display in your house. And we literally, not even 6 months later, the bankers said we couldn't do it. The people said it wasn't possible. They said nobody would ever give to that. And we walked in this place, and the building we stand in now is paid in full. Now, this is the thing I want you to understand right now. It was the faith of people obeying God. And what it did was it gave us the ability to, when we release the debt on this building, it gave us freedom for the future. It made our future unlimited. And you're saying, Mike, okay, what's the future? The future is we always live in crazy faith. The future is, because of what happened in 2014 and because what happened February this year, now our future is unlimited. When you release the debt, and I just want to be very practical, in this Christmas season, y'all don't need to go get in a bunch of debt, because what you're doing is, when you get in the debt, you're tying up your future. You're allowing yourself to limit what, y'all don't hear me, to limit what God can do in the future. Bree can tell you right now, we had an amazing investment opportunity as a church come in this area right here. And the day before we said yes, I prayed and the Holy Spirit said, no, I need you to be available for the future of what I'm about to do. And I said, God, what are you about to do? And he took me back. I thank God, because what you need to know, I need to say this point. Some of you need a vision of forgiveness. You need to get a vision for forgiveness. And you're saying, I got a vision for my life. I got a vision board. I got vision stuff. But no, you need to get a vision for who you need to forgive and for what. You know what the Bible says? Where there is no vision, the people perish. Where there is no prophetic vision, people stop caring. And God began to tell me, he said very practically, Michael, I need you to tell the people today why they need to forgive. It's because when they release the debt, it releases their future. Their future becomes unlimited. I can do anything with them when they're not bound by what happened to them. But they need to, forgiveness needs a vision. Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, the people perish. And this literally was Bree from the front. I'm talking to Bree because my sister, she's about the only one in here today, and she knows this is true. Literally, this was, I went back and I watched the first series that we preached, because the word for Transformation Church this year is stronger. And we said, we're going to get stronger in the middle of a pandemic. How are we going to get stronger? In the middle of all this racial tension, how are we going to get stronger? God said, I didn't change because stuff started happening. I'm the same today, yesterday, and somebody better hear me, and forever. My faith is getting jacked up right now, because I came to tell somebody today, 2020 is not over. God still got about 30 something days. Yeah. I know you're sitting there, but he still got, you know what he can do in 3 days. What about 30? You know what he can conquer death, hell, and the grave in 3, and he can't change your situation in 30. But it takes you being of the right posture to release the debt to bring freedom to the future. Release the debt to bring freedom to the future. And God began to tell me, as I watched the first sermon, the first 3 points of 2020 was that vision needs a vessel. That's why God literally told me, he said, make sure they get a vision for forgiveness. Write down the names of the people you need to forgive. Don't forgive them yet. Just at least write it down and make it plain. I want to be very practical. I need to forgive Joe. I need to forgive Trisha. I need to forgive this person. I need to forgive. They might not even know, but you need to write the vision down and make it. I need to forgive my father. I need to forgive my auntie. I need to forgive that random person with the Trump flag on the back of his F-150 who flipped me off. I don't care. You don't got to know him. It still affected you. I need to forgive them for writing Black Lives Matter on our sidewalk. I don't care what side you're on. You're stopping your future and what God wants to do if you still hold that unforgiveness. He said that the vision, forgiveness needs a vision, and vision needs a vessel. That's why in Luke 18:8, it says, but when the Son of Man returns, how many will he find on the earth who have faith? Who will believe me that it's okay, it takes faith to forgive? Let them go and I'll take care of you. Release them. I got you. I'm the Lord, your shelter, your refuge, the one that you run in and you'll be safe. Let them go. Yeah, come on, hide. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High, me, they shall abide in the shadow of my wing. Like, let them go. Let me handle you. It takes faith to do that. And then it says vision must be visible. That's why I'm telling you to write the things down. The crazy thing that I can say to you today is when I go back to this practical example of what Bishop did to release the debt in 2014, and then what we as a church last year in Crazy Faith did to release the debt on this building. God told me as I was driving up to this place every day, he said, don't let your foot up off the gas. And I said, what? He said, crazy faith was not an event. It's a lifestyle. He said, I didn't ask you if you could believe me again for something bigger. He said, I am the God of everything. He said, I'm just looking for somebody to believe me. So I went back to this sheet that many of you have seen before. This is a sheet that God had me write. Let me call your attention to the date, March 9th, 2015, 37 days after I became the lead pastor of Transformation Church. A lot of people weren't coming to church. Nobody was giving. And I wrote this at 7:29 a.m. in Bella's room, insecure and not knowing if God would ever use me. And the first thing I wrote on there is, the Spirit Bank Event Center will be Transformation Church. I literally spelled transformation wrong. It's like transformation. Like if a trans, I forgot the T. It doesn't even matter, because God can use your imperfections, because he saw me write it down. The vision had a vessel. The vision was made clear and it was vast. And I wrote it down and God said, don't let up off the gas. The Spirit Bank Event Center will be Transformation Church. I was like, you did that, God, crazy faith. We shouted, we believed. And every day I drove up in here, he said, are you believing me? I said, God, for what? He said, go back to the vision I gave you. Highlight this first thing right here for me. It says, we will have as a church, as a kingdom organization, amazing relationships with all the existing businesses and all the major businesses to come. Now this, you may not know this if you've never been to Transformation Church, which thousands of you have not, but our church sits in the back of basically like this business complex. It has over 35 commercial businesses, everything from chiropractic firms to technology companies to a college, and we sit in the back of it. It all looks the same, but our church is in the back of it. And he said, in this area, you will have amazing relationships with all the existing businesses and all the other major businesses to come. Then it says, we will subdue, rule, and dominate in this area. The fact that I was writing this and we hadn't even had a staff of over 10 people, like God saying, but all he needed was a vision and a vessel and somebody who could get it that was vast. And somebody who was prepared by having released the debt to be able to be positioned for the future. Then he said, many business people and their friends and their family, this is the why, will come to Christ because we represented God to them for transformation in Christ. God said, don't take your foot up off the gas. I said, what do you want me to do, God? He said, I want you to believe in crazy faith that in the middle of everything that's going on, that I'm going to give you the entire complex that your church sits in. And I said, God, that would be crazy. And he says, until it happens. He said, it would be crazy until it happens. Well, a few months ago, after I prayed and we turned down that business deal, 2 weeks later, that's why you got to spend time with God. 2 weeks later, because we had released the debt, we had now made our future unlimited. They called us from Post Rock and said, we want to sell the entire complex because of some things that are happening in COVID. And they told us the price. And I said, we're not paying that for that. Tell them, sorry, not sorry. It's not happening. They came back $2 million cheaper. Came through, put new roofs on the building. Have tenant leases for the next 2.5 years. Totally rented out 35 plus commercial spaces, even the land that Chick-fil-A sits on outside. They said, if we drop it to this, is Transformation Church in a position? Are you in the position? And this is the thing that I need everybody to understand. If you don't let those people go, you won't be in the position for God to trust you with that. If you don't let the physical debt go, if you don't let them credit cards and trying to keep up with the Joneses, if you don't let it go, you are not in position. We can have all the faith in the world, but not the position. And then the miracle gets stopped. But I got good news for you, Transformation Church. Because we had released the debt and we had made our future unlimited, on Tuesday, I went and signed on our behalf for the keys to the entire Post Rock business complex. I came to tell you, I got the keys! Transformation Church, you don't know, y'all don't hear me. Glory to God. Only God could do this. Only crazy faith could do this. Only releasing the debt and being in position. What you don't understand is that this piece of property and this acquisition that the church was able to make positions us to do kingdom work. I don't have to ask for an offering to do certain things now, because the wealth of people that was not in the kingdom were laid up for people who were righteous and in the kingdom. This building, what it will bring in, this entire complex, over 35 plus businesses, what they will bring in after everything is done will be over $1.5 million. And for the next 3 years, every cent of that, the equivalent, will be given away in missions. You missed it. That's not to keep the lights on. That's to end sex trafficking. That's to get the Bible all over the world. That's to help plant churches. That's to feed people in the middle of a pandemic. That's to, it's representing. We get to take every dollar from that investment and put it back into the community. Somebody said, y'all forgot about North Tulsa. No. We just went to go get some resources so that we could put it back into the school. Y'all don't hear me. So that we could change the trajectory. I'm celebrating the crazy faith miracle because I believe this is what God wants to do in your life. There are keys to things with your name on it. There are keys to your freedom, keys to your peace, keys to your sanity, to the miracle you need. But remember what this came from. Not just crazy faith. It came from releasing the debt and allowing your future to be unlimited. Why do we forgive? Not because they deserve it. It's because God desires it. And when we release them, our future is unlimited. Pastor Mike, what? Okay, so what are we doing? Like, I'm declaring today in front of you that within 1 year, that property cost $20.5 million. Oh my God, why are we talking about that in the middle of a pandemic? Because God's not done positioning his children for when we're out of the pandemic to be in kingdom position. You missed it. Every time there's a crash or a distress or anything, somebody's getting positioned to be in a place of authority when all of it's over. And God is trying to position the church. If we would stop arguing and stop getting distracted and actually forgive, stop picking up offense, if you would get in the face of God and hear him, he's trying to position his kids in crazy faith to be in a position of authority when all of this is over. We put about $6 million down cash because of your generosity and your faithfulness. This is not about Pastor Mike. I can't buy that building. We did that. Everybody, even Transformation Church, Transformation Nation, all over the world, we are taking territory for the kingdom. That complex has 7 addresses attached to it. We now own almost 9 or 10 properties in Tulsa, and there's more coming. Why? It's because we want to have something to pass on to the next generation. We don't just want to give them prayers. We don't just want to hand them debts and notes. We want to hand them kingdom properties. We want to hand them a future. We want to hand them something that's not limited. Bishop handed me a future unlimited. And that's why we're able to do this. And it is my vow and everybody that's here that when it's time for Bella and it's time for Nathan and it's time for Arlo and it's time for your children to step into the kingdom of God, people will be able to say, my parents stood in faith. They sowed, my brothers and sisters, my cousins, that man down the street, that scientist, that computer technician, they sowed in crazy faith when it didn't make any sense. And they released the debt so that our future could be unlimited. Church, why do you need to forgive? Forgive for your future. Is it that simple? Forgive for your future. Why are we going to give next week? We're going to give for the future. This will be paid off in 1 year by the grace of God. I'm marking it. I want you to play this video back because we're going to stand in crazy faith. And then after he does that, What's next? Is it a campus in a different continent? Oh, see, y'all thinking low. Y'all thinking low. Like, what continent should we come to next? Is it buying the BLK Center because we need more space? When God starts doing, see, I'm trying to stretch you. I'm trying to take you. Is it going and partnering with churches and paying for their salaries for the first 2 years of ministry so they don't have to worry about trying to, y'all don't hear me. They don't have to worry about trying to raise money. Just do what God said to do. Is it going and partnering with Convoy of Hope or the Dream Center or churches that are just getting started? Is it, what can we do? It don't matter, because when the debt is released, our future is unlimited. But before God wants this for the organization, he wants it for the organism. What are you saying, Pastor Mike? Forgive him and release your future. Today, I want to pray for you. Come on, hands lifted all over the world. It takes crazy faith to believe for that building and for it to be paid off in a year, but it takes more crazy faith to trust God to forgive. And today, I'm going to pray that as you release the debt, somebody's going to naturally feel their future being released and unlocked and unlimited. Father, in the name of Jesus, we cannot do this without you. And that's why you sent Jesus to release us of our debt so that we could release others. God, there are people right now that their emotions are everywhere because they want to obey you. They want to do it. They don't want to be called wicked and evil servants who experience the grace and forgiveness of God but can't extend it. But God, it's hard. We don't know how to erase the moments and the memories and the lines that have been crossed and the hurt and the words. But by your Holy Spirit, I thank you right now that, Father, all across the world, you're doing a miracle, that you are coming into places where we don't even get how this is going to happen. And Father, we're saying we're available. We want it. Father God, in your word tells us that you are the God that gives us the desire and the will to do and the power to do what pleases you. Father God, right now through this message, many people are getting the desire to forgive, that we want to try, Father God. But right now we need you to do the hard work so that we can have the power to do it, Father, that we, not in our own self, not with good intentions, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, the one that you call Comforter, the Paraclete, the one that walks alongside of us to help. God, I thank you that you're going to give us the ability to even take the first step practically and write down who we need to forgive. Father, with tears in our eyes, with tears dropping on the paper, let us sketch down the names of the people. Let us get pictures of them, Father God, and say we desire to forgive, Father God. And as we desire to forgive, Father God, I thank you that we make it visible and we are the vessels that are going to do your kingdom work on earth, Father God. And I thank you that you would do a miracle that no amount of money could do, that no building could do, Father, that no person could do. Father, heal and transform our hearts. Father, we've been in this series for 10 weeks and some people, they're just starting to crack and be open to this. But you said this year for Transformation Church, we would get stronger. And God, I thank you that right now in crazy faith, I think the strongest thing we could do is forgive so that our future can be unlimited. We want to do whatever you want us to do, God. And I thank you that unforgiveness will not hold us back another day. In Jesus' name. In that same attitude right there, because people, God's doing surgery right now on your heart, I want to give you the opportunity to receive Jesus. Because some of you this whole time have been intellectually trying to figure out how you're going to forgive these people. And God said, this is the greatest deal of all time. That because you wouldn't be able to do this, I sent my son. And I forgave you of everything that you would ever do. All you have to do is receive it according to Romans 10:9. And if you put your faith in Jesus, that he lived and he died just for you, then what happens from that point is now God does not hold your sins, your faults, your pain, your trash against you. He only sees his son. And all he asks in return is that you would extend that same love to somebody else. Some of you are trying to extend the love and the grace and the forgiveness to somebody else, but you've never first received it. Today is the perfect day for you to receive the forgiveness of God. And I know religion tells you you need to clean up, that you need to change. I know some of you right now are planning to do things after this service that would not bring God glory. And some of you did them last night, and some of you smell like where you've been, and you smell like who you've been with. And I'm telling you that religion would tell you to change all of that, but relationship says, come as you are. God is the only one that you can come to him broken, jacked up, messed up, still with the habit. Well, stop smoking, stop drinking, stop this, stop all that stuff. God says, no, just come to me. If you give me your heart, I'll help you change your habit. And today, that's what I'm offering you. What better way to go into the last month of this new year by receiving forgiveness and salvation and walking free so your future can be unlimited? If you want to be a part of this prayer, it's the prayer that changed my life, took me from being somebody that was addicted to pornography, a manipulator, somebody who was doing all kinds of bad stuff. And now I'm not a perfect person, but I'm a progressing person because of the love of Jesus Christ. Today, I want you to receive that. I don't care if you're in a sexually alternate lifestyle. I don't care who you've broken. I don't care what's happened to you. God loves you. He cares for you. And he wants to help you. If you're saying, Pastor, I want to be included in that prayer, I don't care who's sitting next to you. I don't care who's around you. Right now is the moment of salvation. If you want to receive that level of freedom, grace, and forgiveness, just throw your hand on the air on the count of three. One, it's the greatest decision you could ever make. Two, I'm so proud of you, but more than that, God is proud of you. Three, come on, shoot your hand up in the air. I believe there's hundreds, if not thousands of people that their hands are going up all over the world. Even if you're watching this on rebroadcast, there's no distance. God sees you right there. You can put your hands down. Right now, we're going to pray together. You said, God, I want you to come in and release me of the debt so my future can be unlimited. And right now at Transformation Church, we are family. We all pray together. So for the benefit of those who are coming to Christ all over the world, wherever you are, I want you to pray this prayer with me. Everybody say, God, thank you for sending Jesus to release me of the debt. Today, I believe that you are the Son of God, and you lived, you died, and you rose again just for me. Today, I receive your forgiveness. Today, I receive your grace. Today, I receive your love. Change me, renew me, transform me. I'm yours in Jesus' name. Amen. Can we give God praise all over the world right now? There are thousands of people, I believe by the Spirit, who have just put their faith in Jesus. Heaven is turning up right now over one person. And today we give God glory. Let me tell you, you're released of the debt. And now your future is unlimited. F you. Future unlimited. God is so good, man. And this is what it's all about. I hope today your faith is inspired to forgive and to give. Next week, we're about to see God do something amazing. I don't know. I might say somebody might go ahead and pay for the whole thing. We might next week. I'll throw it out there in 15 million. I don't know who has it, but somebody may be moved. But if not, it don't matter. We've seen God do it before, and he's going to do it again. He's the same God right now. He's the same God back then. We won't be moved. And I'm asking you and your family to pray about partnering with us. Use this week to pray. All I'm asking you to do is pray. And as you pray, I believe God is going to give you an answer. And then I want you to come next week in crazy faith. There'll be people here every day starting tomorrow at 7 a.m. So you can come. You can go to work and drop it off on your way to work or on your way from work. Or bring your kids and your family and teach them what you're doing and grow in this. Some of you can do it right now. There's an option for the crazy faith offering up. You can just go and do it. But I'm telling you, as a church, we're going to grow and we're going to finish this year strong. I love you. I believe in you. I see God building our church stronger and deeper. Remember what we said, bigger is not always better, stronger is. And I just feel like through this series, we lost all the fans through this series and we got the faithful. Like, this is not a fan series. This is not like, I need to forgive. Like, I ain't getting nothing. I ain't like, this is one that your faith got deeper. If you made it through week 10 of this series, you're stronger. And I'm just so grateful to lead a church that moves in the things of God and in generosity and in love. I love you. This week, this is going to be the best week you ever had. And I believe that we're going to move in faith and you're going to go out and live a transformed life. I'll see you next week. God bless you.
What's going on, family? I wanted to come and personally tell you about something that is a tradition here at Transformation Church. At the end of every year, we bring our faith, our crazy faith, to an offering. We call it our end of the year offering. And what we do is we set aside a moment to ask God, hey, is there anything you want us to give? Give to this mission, this vision, this idea of representing God across the whole world. And literally for the past 6 years, we've been doing it, and it has been the catalyst for everything else that we've done as a church. We've been able to help end sex trafficking. We've been able to buy this building and pay for it in 5 months because of the generosity. The cameras that you are watching us on right now were because of somebody's crazy faith to give in at an end of the year offering. I think back, and literally when the church first started, it was the faith of a few people, less than 300, who gave $80,000 that produced the cameras that are seeing so many. Over 19,000 salvations have come this year, but it started with the faith of somebody. And I want to ask you to partner with us. Join in, not giving an amount, asking God, is there something you want me to give? And I promise you, when you ask him, he'll speak to you. This is not about amounts. This is about growing in our faith. And I know that in a year where many of us would be tempted to hoard or keep or protect what we have, at Transformation Church, we move in generosity. We give just to give, not to get. We step out in faith. We believe in God and we believe in miracles. And I believe that God right now is placing something on you and your family's heart, like he's doing for me and Natalie and our family. And we're all on December 6th gonna give in our crazy faith offering. I'm telling you, what I've seen God do in this season of the year has been something that will never, ever, nobody can ever convince me that God is not moving in this moment. And so I want you to join us. This is the step of faith that maybe you've been praying for. This is the step of faith that's going to prove that all the growth as we've gotten stronger this year actually has action in your life. And I'm so grateful, and I'm gonna be praying with you that whatever God says for you to give, you would obey. See, what we know is that obedience is better than any sacrifice we could give. And we're gonna move this thing together. So December 6th, Crazy Faith Offering, you can give, and I'm so excited to see what God does in this church as we represent him to the lost and found for transformation in Christ. God bless you.